Mr. Diefenbaker, the last time a government was defeated was your government in 1963. How do you feel about what's been going on there this afternoon?
The question I wanted to ask the government was simply this. This house is over. This parliament is ended. And I wanted to ask them whether they would follow the constitutional principle that no appointments will be made between now and election day. They don't want to make that assurance. They want to get in touch with the Governor General and endeavor to make appointments that should be set aside in the event that they do.
You feel that some appointments are about to be made?
Well, that's what it's very apparent. They knew what I had in mind. That's why they try to hollow me down. But that doesn't worry me. But when the Speaker directs me not to, that he won't allow the question, and I obey. But this government will endeavor to plug the Senate seats. They were defeated on a vote of non-confidence. So was I. And I made no appointments between the time of the election.
You're arguing that it has no power at all to do anything right now.
They can only do such things as are absolutely necessary in order to carry on government.
Okay,
but no more.
Let's ask the big political questions now, Mr. Diefenbaker. What's going to happen in the West?
What's going to
happen in the West? Are you going to have a good...
I never make predictions, but in Western Canada, the situation is such that everybody realizes that Mr. Trudeau doesn't give a tinker's damn for Western Canada. And they haven't lost sight of the fact that his whole attitude throughout has been one of contemptuous disregard of the equality rights of our Western province.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Diefenbaker. Now to John Drury with Robert Stanfield, the Conservative leader.
Mr. Stanfield, you've been waiting for this for 18 months. Now that you seem to be in the driver's seat, what happens? How do you feel?
Well, I'm happy that the government's been defeated, of course, and we have an election coming on now. I assume that there'll be no argument about this being a vote of confidence as far as the government's concerned. So we'll have an early election, July the 8th or something like that. And that's our next job, to fight a good election, to take our case to the people, to convince the Canadian people that we can do a better job than the government's been doing.
What's your first move, Mr. Stanfield, right at this moment? Where do you go from here starting tomorrow?
Well, I go to a caucus tomorrow. Our caucus will be meeting our campaign people to be briefed on our campaign. That's what I'll be doing first.
Have you got a slogan yet, Mr. Stanfield?
I can't tell you. I'm sure that there's been a good deal of work done on slogans, but
Mr. Stanfield, you really got to where you are at this particular moment by support of the NDP. Do you expect their support if your party becomes the government?
Well, we're not thinking those terms yet. We're out to get a majority. And of course, that'll be for the people of Canada to decide, but we're not worrying about minority situations until one develops.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stanfield. I believe we have Mr. Turner now coming in to speak to Ron Collister.
Thank you, John. Well, John Turner, the Finance Minister. What went wrong with your budget, Mr. Turner?
Well, I think the opposition parties had made up their mind before they ever saw the budget. And the budget was written... As I try to write every budget for Parliament and the Canadian people, now the Canadian people will have to decide what they think of it.
Okay, now the criticism of it, and I'm just echoing what the opposition said, was that it didn't do enough for people.
Well, it switched about $1 billion from the big corporations to the average person in this country, and I feel that is a good deal within the limits of responsibility that are imposed upon me to handle the taxpayers' money.
Okay, now it's quite obvious that the Conservatives and others think that inflation is going to be the big issue. Now, how do you answer that? Can you say that inflation will be under control before this campaign is over, or is it something we're going to have to live with for years?
When I address myself to the subject in the election campaign, I'll try to do what I've done to Parliament, to come clean with the Canadian people, to tell the facts the way I see them, analyze the causes of inflation, and describe what we've tried to do to give us the best record in the world on a very difficult subject.
Okay, come clean with us now. Would you tell us how high the rate of inflation is going to be this year?
No, I said to Parliament, and I'd have to say to Canadians, that with all these worldwide forces in play on food, on world-traded commodities, now on petroleum, that no one anywhere in any country would be able to predict what the rate of inflation will be this year.
What does the Liberal Party want to fight this election on? What's the issue, Mr. Turner?
We'll fight it on the record of the government. We'll fight it on the management of the economy. We'll fight it on the leadership of the Prime Minister as the man best able to weld this country and mold this country into a unified, progressive nation.
You had any trouble, did you have any trouble in selling this particular kind of budget, which may have been economically sound, but maybe wasn't quite as politically sexy as some of your supporters would have liked it?
No, there's one always has to draw the limits between sex and discipline, and this is a budget that has a bit of both.
Mr. Turner, are you going to tell us tomorrow what the implications of this vote are on the future of the provisions in your budget?
Well, if Parliament is dissolved, then I'll have something to say about what happens to the budget.
Why'd you say if it's dissolved? Surely it's going to be dissolved.
Well, I assume that, but it's not my prerogative to recommend to the Governor General what will happen. So as if and when Parliament is dissolved, then I'll have something to say about what happens to the budget.
It may only be an academic question, but is there some other course that the Prime Minister could follow at this time other than dissolving? Could he ask the Governor General to ask Mr. Stanfield, a former governor?
Oh, there are a number of things he could do, but it's his prerogative as to what he wants to do.
You would expect him, though, to ask for dissolution?
I would expect him to ask for a dissolution.
Yeah,
but I'm not going to presume on what he's going to do.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Norton.
Thank you. Well, just to fill bring you up to date again, as you can see by the scramble here in the foyer of the Commons, something of great importance has happened. The government has been defeated by 137 to 123, and it seems that the country is on its way to a federal election on July the 8th, one expects. Now, here's David Lewis, who's changed vote. Brought down the government. How do you feel, Mr. Lewis?
Well, I feel the way I think one ought to feel. The government brought it down on itself. It produced a budget that was unacceptable to anyone with any sensitivity about the needs of the Canadian people and the cost of living. To ask us to support a budget that gave the ordinary worker 96 cents a week in a tax cut is just irresponsible, and the Prime Minister was responsible for it, and the government had to come down. I think they were becoming paralytic almost, and the people of Canada will have the opportunity to say whether the kind of budget that the government presented is right or wrong. And I enter the campaign with a great deal of happiness and a great deal of confidence.
I'm told this is the first time in the history of Canada that a government has been brought down in a vote on a budget. How do you explain that? Was it just bad planning, or was it deliberate?
I think it was bad planning by the government. I think what happened was that they had reverted to the kind of arrogance and insensitivity which they had shown when they were a majority government. Mr. Trudeau sort of reeled back into his old pose and took the NDP for granted. He thought we were frightened about an election. He was crazy. We're not. We never were. We aren't now. We said that we would look at everything before us and its merits. That's what we did. When the budget is poor, when it doesn't deal with the needs of the Canadian people, then the government has to go down.
Mr. Lewis, you have plunged the country into an election at a time of bad inflation, and there'll be a period now where nothing gets done whatsoever while you people go out on the hustings and fight the election. Do you have any reservations at all about
that? Not the slightest, because the budget of the government did nothing for it anyway, so that nothing would have been done if we'd been sitting here yapping at each other and scratching each other's eyes out. When you get Parliament into a situation where the government is not being productive, where it isn't being constructive, then all that happens in Parliament is a lot of eye scratching and not useful work. At that point, it's better for a new Parliament, and Canada will survive. It's a strong country, and the people will see to it that it survives.
Mr. Lewis, what's the issue? What's the issue that you're going to take out to the people?
In my opinion, the issue is the rising cost of living for the people of Canada, and I suggest, with conviction that we have the only policy that really meets it. You can't have an overall price and wage freeze, that is impossible, but you can have selective price control. You can have a two-price system so that Canadians don't have to pay the artificially high prices that the international market commands. You can have a national prices control board in order to roll back unjustified prices. We can establish a 6% mortgage interest rate, and by these means really reduce the pressure of prices on the ordinary Canadian. Then on the other side, in order to be able to do that, you have to compensate the people that suffer most because you're not going to remove all the price rises. Therefore, what we needed was some additional help for the pensioners, for the low-income people of Canada, for the working poor. And in order to have the money to do those things, the corporations ought to have been made to pay their share of the tax
instead of letting them get away with billions of dollars.
The criticism we hear of your party's position, Mr. Lewis, I'm not putting it forward as my own, is that you're advocating that that profits be frozen, but not the incomes side of this whole control program. Yeah. You're not willing to go along with an incomes freeze policy.
Because the incomes freeze, the word incomes is a misleading word, you know. What does it include? If it includes profits and dividends and so on, we're not trying to freeze profits. That is not the idea. And I'm not suggesting any kind of policy like that. I am saying that the taxation system of this country ought to bring into the public treasury a large proportion of the large profits made by the corporation in order to have the $2 or $3 billion necessary to improve the lot of the pensioners and the working poor and to do something about housing on a large scale. This isn't going after the corporation for the fun of it. This is going where the money is to make it available for the benefit of Canadians.
Is it all going to be worthwhile, though? What happens if we come back to another minority government situation?
I think the election will be worthwhile, whatever the result. I'm not talking about a minority government situation. My intention is to ask the Canadian people to look seriously at the program of the NDP in this election and to think seriously of giving us a chance to govern this country. But the election will have a very valuable effect on all spokesmen of parties and on all members of parties. It will be good to hear what the people have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Lewis.
Later in the evening, as the returns from the West Coast confirmed his victory, Prime Minister Trudeau finally made his way into the ballroom of the Chateau Laurier in Ottawa. Reporters were quick to note he refused to answer questions, but if they expected arrogance, they were disappointed. Mr. Trudeau's speech was a model of courtesy and tact.
I think I would only add, in closing, that there's still much to do in Canada. We have talked during the election about our policies and our programs. I want to make it perfectly clear that they will apply without any sort of favoritism to every part of Canada. I am sorry that we have not more members from particularly the prairie provinces. I just want to renew my pledge that I made at the time of the Western Economic Opportunities Conference that we will do our best to make sure our policies apply with fairness to them, and particularly the aspects of our policies which I tried to spell out then and now. We will make sure that if we can succeed, we will show to the parts of Canada that we are not as strong as we would like, that we intend to be a government for all Canadians. We have, I hope, a few years of parliamentary stability before us. We have the people, we have the resources, we have the vitality and the confidence to do a very great job in a world where there have been many problems and there will be more problems, but in a world where Canada has come out of this election strong, confident in its future. I just want to say that I'm very anxious to get on with the job, and I'm sure Margaret and the children will be glad that this election period is over. I want to thank you, Margaret, for your great help. We'll get on with the job, both our jobs.